Okay. Hello, everyone. Thank you so much for making the time to join us in our first event of the year. And welcome to the SI Cape Town Hub. My name is Arsene Ngombe. I'm the Hub Lead. I'm here with the SI Cape Town Hub team. I have Linda Kuvea, Leah Udemans, and Sheldon Subeb. But also, it's important to notify that our team is growing as we've been into this journey for a long time. So we are joined today also by Billy, Moses Billy, who's part of the extended team, as well as Boy Tumelo Nkonde, who will be also part of the extended team. So the session tonight will be co-facilitated by myself and Linda. My other colleagues will be picking up some questions from the audience as we go along. So today we have an amazing panel on the recently released Global Risk Report 2023-1 by the World Economic Forum, which was published last month. But let me clarify that our goal tonight is to really move away from merely debating the severity of the challenges we face globally and locally. We'll rather focus on some of the approaches that will help us in understanding systemic risks and explore new territories, but also kind of find out what they mean in the context of South Africa, and also possibly how indigenous knowledge fits in that process. But before we take a deep dive into the topic of tonight, I want to check, just have an idea who's in the room. So if you can just let us know through the chat, write your name and tell us where you're joining us from. And then we can, so that we get a sense of the people that we have in the room. In the meantime, also I will give a few people a few minutes to join as we go. Before I call my colleague Linda to start talking about the event. Okay, I saw Nick. Nick, welcome. It's always nice to have you here. Okay. I see some few people from Cape Town. Yeah, Linda.
Yeah.
Cool. Sounds good. I guess we will get more people as we go, but without really wasting too much time, I would like to hand over to Linda to give us the flow of the events and also introduce our speakers of tonight. Linda, to you.
Thank you so much, Arsene, and greetings to you all, and thank you so much for making time to join us today in this conversation. So before we get into it, I'll just talk about the flow of the event, just to give us an idea of what to expect. So we're going to start by presentation from each of our panelists, and then after those presentations, we'll basically just go into the conversation with follow-up questions, and we are going to open up the floor for people to ask questions or share some ideas. And if you are not able to talk, you can also drop anything in the chat, your ideas, your questions, and your perspectives. I would really highly recommend or encourage us all to participate as a way to ensure that the conversation takes into consideration various perspectives. So, I'll take this opportunity now to introduce to you our speakers for tonight. And our first speaker is Dr. Anthony Masys. He's a systems thinker, educator, speaker, and solution navigator. He holds 5 academic appointments nationally in Canada, where he's based, and internationally, and has conducted workshops and keynote addresses across 5 continents, on various topics ranging from applied systems thinking, scenario planning, and red teaming to transformational and generative leadership development. He's also an editor-in-chief for the Springer Book Series, and he is he's an author and editor of over 20 books on disaster management, enabling resilience, exploring the security landscape, also looking at security by design, global health security, and a lot more. You can look him up and have a look at the stuff that he does. So yeah, that's Dr. Anthony Masys. And our second speaker is Michael Haupt. He's a former technology executive who helped launch the mobile telephony industry in South Africa in 1994. And after moving to Australia in 1996, he went on to implement complex computer systems for telephone companies and banks in 16 cities on six continents. Then in 2004, he then left the corporate world and started working on complex systemic issues. And since then, he has consulted with a wide range of systemic initiatives globally. But more recently, he has been involved on the on the ground citizen-led initiatives in Wolseley and Greyton here in Western Cape, in the Western Cape province in South Africa. He knows from bitter experience that the challenges we face are significant. He also knows from history that they are insurmountable. So now he has launched Life Legacy AI and works with heart-centered individuals who want to leave a meaningful legacy without giving their money to their well-deserved wealth to charity and meaningless causes. So this is Michael Haupt. And so now we'll quickly get into the presentations. I'll call upon you, Anthony, to share your presentation. And when you are done, Michael, you can also jump in and share your presentation. Then we'll get into the discussion. Over to you, Anthony.
Very good. Thank you very much for this opportunity to speak with you today. And you can see my slide?
Yes, yeah.
Excellent. So again, thank you very much for the invitation to come and speak with you today. Today I'll focus on looking at and better understanding what systemic risks are all about. As you see on the slide, there's a little blue dot on the right-hand side. If you would just indulge me for a moment, I want you to just take a look at where you're sitting right now. Take 5 seconds and try to find and count as many things that are the color blue. So look around you right now in your office, wherever you're sitting, and look for the color blue. You got 4 seconds, 3, 2, and 1. Excellent. Now just close your eyes for a moment and try to recount everything that you saw that was the color red. And again, the key message I want to bring from this one is that what we focus on shapes what we see. If we focus on blue, we're going to see blue and not see the red. If you're going to take anything away from this presentation, it's this phrase here: to do differently, we must think differently. And with that, I'll be introducing the whole notion about systems thinking and about perspective, just like the blue dot, how perspective is key in terms of how we understand the problem space, but how we design solutions in that as well. You know, we've seen around the world in our own communities that different natural disasters, different shocks, you know, extreme heat, extreme cold. We have wildfires, the virus, we have coronavirus, we have floods. All those and many more have actually stress tested the resilience of our societal systems. The COVID-19 pandemic was a really important shock to us, allowed us to reflect on it and better understand, you know, when we focus on health actions in discrete and short-term perspectives, we actually lose sight of the potential consequences. And I guess another key message is that, you know, we have intended outcomes, but there's always unintended outcomes that we have to better understand. Hence, the systems thinking approach is key. The WEF every year puts out their global risk landscape. And they do a beautiful job in terms of creating some visuals for us to better understand the complexity of risks that exist locally, regionally, and globally. You know, when we take a look at these diagrams that WEF puts together, it's not what it is, but what it does for us, which is important. And just by looking at these diagrams, we start to seeing that, you know, we can't just focus on one risks. They're all interdependent, interconnected. It allows us to understand the cascading effects of risks, but also allows us to reflect upon intervention strategies, looking for those leverage points by understanding the risk landscape. The COVID-19 is a perfect example of the requirement for paradigm shift. You know what, we focus on a narrow focus of the health side of the pandemic, but we have to understand that single risks, things are beyond just single risks. There's multi-hazards, multi-sector approaches to better understand the cascading effects of risks. So this paradigm shift allows us, it requires us to address the systemic nature of risks. Taleb, in his book on anti-fragility, he says something very profound. He says that not seeing a tsunami or an economic event coming is excusable. Building something fragile to them is not. And I think that's a powerful, for that, for me, that's a call for action. We have to understand our risk landscape and make sure we're not building fragility into our systems. So we can really characterize a lot of the problems around the world as wicked problems. Humanity's facing these wicked problems of global climate change, the pandemic, systemic racism, economic inequality. So we have to understand how these wicked problems emerge, how they're created, how they're perpetuated, and what are the vulnerabilities that exist in our societal systems that continue to perpetuate these wicked problems. So when we think about global health ecosystem, we look at the natural hazards, the flooding, for example, and we really, again, from a systemic perspective, we really understand that things like climate change are actually exposing existing inequalities. You know, not everyone experiences disasters in the same way. Oftentimes, it's the vulnerable populations or the vulnerabilized populations that experience these disasters the worst. You know, there's an inherent fragility in our global, for example, health ecosystems. There's cascading effects. And what we have to really understand is that we have to understand this fragility exists, and there's an inherent interdependency across our societal systems. And having an understanding of that will allow us to better design resilient communities, given the risk landscape. So we can really take a look at the world we live in, and it's termed, we live in under conditions what are called VUCA. We live in conditions of volatility, uncertainty, complexity, ambiguity. And that really affects how we view the world, how we experience the world, and how we make decisions to deal with some of these risks. And really focuses, you know, often governments have a lack of understanding of, you know, managing these VUCA conditions or understand these VUCA conditions and planning for uncertain futures and actually what we can actually do today to achieve desired outcomes. So anticipation becomes a key skill set, a key mindset for dealing with or living in this VUCA world. Just last year, we actually published, I was part of a team that worked with the UNDRR and published a report on better understanding the cascading and systemic risks. So lessons learned from COVID-19. And the link is there, take a look at it. It's a fabulous document put together. And again, one of the key messages from this presentation and from that report as well is to do differently, we must think differently. You know, the OEC's general secretary, he really captured it well, you know, when he said that unless we adopt a systems approach, unless we employ systems thinking, we will fail to understand the world we live in. That's a call for action. That's a real powerful paradigm shift that's required. So we introduced this notion of systems thinking, and systems thinking really looking at the interrelationships, bringing different perspectives to the table rather than just focusing on blue. Focus on the other colors as well, and understanding what boundaries we're creating by looking at it from a systems perspective. So when we look at the world around us, we look at major disasters, we have these events, again, in these iceberg model, which is a fabulous model. We look at these events that take place and we react to these events. But when systems thinking, we want to look below the surface of the water at the real content of the iceberg. So we look at the patterns. What patterns exist that are creating these events? So it forces us or invites us to actually anticipate. We look at the underlying structures that feed those patterns that, again, invites us to actually design resilient strategies. And even more important, the fundamental part is actually having the right mental models to transform our mental models to really address in advance what some of these major disasters would give rise to. So systemic risk in COVID-19, we look at COVID-19, we look at the health risks. But we also look again from the UNDR report that there was a ripple effect that emerged from the health effects that extended, and this is key in terms of systemic risks. It extended to the economic, the social, and the political domains. It just wasn't a health crisis. It was a global, multidimensional crisis as well. Here's a beautiful map that I found on the internet, and it shows sort of the first order effects of the COVID-19 and the second order and the third order. And I think that's important for us to recognize when we think about systems in terms of our decision-making. When we make a decision, there's intended consequences and there's unintended consequences. So really systemic risks are really emerge from this interconnectivity, this interdependence that exists across our societal systems. It really focuses on elements of interdependence, interconnectedness, and cascading effects. We recognize that there's non-linear relationships. So a small effect, a small input can have a huge effect. There's feedback loops. There's tipping points in systemic risks. There are things that are being unnoticed. There's a resident uncertainty, and things are very dynamic when we're dealing with this sort of systemic risk that exists in our societal systems. Here's one of the maps that you'll find in the UNDR report. It really captures the whole notion of systemic risks and unintended consequences. And what this map, what this diagram actually shows, you know, with the coronavirus at the center, there's a whole bunch of interdependent and interconnectivities everywhere from the effect on social protection, on food insecurity, on intimate partner violence. There's a whole bunch of things that are interdependent and interconnected to better understand what this risk landscape looks like. So just in final thoughts, when we think about some of these major crises that exist, like the COVID-19, we have to look at sort of that crisis management and really adjust ourselves to these transboundary and compound and multi-risks that exists and multi-hazards at risk. It's really about looking at risks and disasters that they're not really specific to certain sectors, but they transcend sectors, transcend geographical regions and periods of time as well. Really recognizing that there's cascading and ripple effects across society and societal systems from disasters and from our interventions in managing some of these disasters. Wyke and Sutcliffe in their book, they have a beautiful quote. It's unexpected events often audit our resilience. That's powerful. Everything that was left unprepared becomes a complex problem. Every weakness comes rushing to the forefront. And this really forces us, or introduces us, invites us to recognize the existence of systemic risk, to better understand the interdependencies and to better prepare ourselves and prepare and create a resilient strategy for our communities. Einstein said it beautifully when he said, the problems we have cannot be solved at the same level of thinking that created them. So really, the key message from this is that we have to do differently. We must think differently. Bringing a systems lens to the perspective allows us to understand the interdependencies, the interconnectivities, the boundaries, the cascading effects that risks have across societal systems. And probably more important is that our intervention strategies always have intended consequences, but we have to recognize the unintended consequences as well. And that concludes my presentation. Thank you very much for your attention.
Thank you. Thank you so much, Anthony. Michael?
There we go. I'm just getting a screen going. Fabulous. Well, thank you so much, Dr. Anthony. I appreciated your kicking off with the blue and red context setting exercise, because I'm going to take a slightly different view at the systemic risks we face. And for context, I've been in this space, as Linda mentioned at the beginning, for quite a few years. And so I've seen a whole lot of different perspectives on the risks we face. And usually it's reasonably difficult to navigate what is a messy and uncertain space. So let's just acknowledge that we are staring into the abyss. You know, everybody has their own favorite polycrisis, meta-crisis, whatever it may be that they refer to, but it is, things are so messy now that it's almost beyond knowing how and where to start and how to take conscious and wise action. And in essence, we are witnessing a profound transformation of just about every system that makes up society. So it's not a simple task that we're dealing with here. But one thing that helps us navigate is history. If we look back at history, we can see patterns and cycles that repeat. And if we take some time to really analyze these patterns, we can gain a deeper understanding of where the world is in a developmental cycle, and then what our role in that world is. So there's a huge body of work called social cycle theory, and it's a framework that was originally developed by Carol Quigley, but many others have built on his work. And his seminal book was The Evolution of Civilizations. It was a meta study of a number of different civilizations, trying to understand if there were patterns that could be identified from each collapse. And he basically identified seven phases as civilization progresses from youth all the way through to maturity. I'll read them out quickly. The first is mixture, then gestation, expansion, then an age of conflict, universal empire that ultimately leads to decay and eventually either invasion from an external force or collapse from internal rot. Now, I normally spend an hour just unpacking what each of those phases mean, but for the purposes of this exercise, all that we need to know is that this pattern is repeated over and over again, quite methodically and quite accurately all the way, beg your pardon, all the way through history. So we're going to look more at those patterns. Now, what I've done over the past 15 to 20 years, I had a hunch that our globalized civilization has followed these similar patterns, but nobody's done any work on this yet because our civilization hasn't collapsed. So there's been no reason to research it and dig into the kind of detail. But I've taken some major world events to see if I could fit them into these seven phases that quickly identified. To make it work, well, I had to go all the way back to what happened immediately after the Roman and Byzantine empires collapsed. And what we had was a period of the 30-year wars and 80-year wars, which were pretty traumatic all the way across Europe. But it ended in 1658 with the Peace of Westphalia. And these were two peace treaties that closed this calamitous period of Roman history. It was a period during which about 8 million people were killed, according to most records. And by the time the treaties were signed, the Roman and Byzantine empires had totally collapsed. So that, in essence, then brought forth a new form of civilization. So I've taken, as I mentioned, these dates that have happened across history at a very high level. And the seven phases are roughly as follows. So up until 1776, we had this mixture period, reasonable stability, but there was a desire for the US to break free from Great Britain. And so the Declaration of Independence was signed. And then from about 1760, we had the two industrial revolutions occurring at pretty much the same time, one in the US, one in the UK. And that kicked off into the third phase of expansion with the Monroe Declaration. I just went blank there for a minute. And that was almost a statement made by the US that we are now going to become a global force to be reckoned with. And that led up to the formation of NATO in 1949, and that became kind of the global military force. Then between 1914, you had the two major world wars and more period of conflict and tension. And specifically, overshoot started raising its head then. So in 1972, the Club of Rome report Limits to Growth was published. And that was really the first time that we became aware that, hold on, we're living a little bit expensively on the planet. And then all the way from the 1970s through to 2009, this is where we started seeing phase five, where you see economic crises, but more importantly, hubris. And hubris is where you have individuals who start seeing solutions to the world. And this eventually led to the World Economic Forum, where we have a group of people now imposing all kinds of solutions on humanity. So from 2009 onwards, we then started entering and a phase of totalitarianism. I'll get into a bit more detail about what we mean by that. But specifically, the pandemic in the 2020s showed that we had some very totalitarian regimes imposing sometimes very harsh lockdown situations, all under the guise of the pandemic. Okay, so it's taken me a fair amount of time to put this model together, and there is a download. There's an infographic with a huge amount of research that goes behind this. Obviously, we're covering this at a very, very high level. But why did I go into all this effort? Why was it necessary? And the main reason is because I wanted a well-constructed cognitive map that can help us navigate through the complexities we face. Having spent so much time in the systemic change world, you have a number of different perspectives. And without this historical context, we sometimes miss what's really unfolding. And many have found the model hopeful. I hope you will too. As I say, it's free to download. We'll ping the link in the chat box. Now, the most important lesson that comes from this model is that each phase has very distinctive characteristics. You can very easily tell by looking at the characteristics which phase a country is in. But remember that I'm looking at it, at this from a global perspective. And with the benefit of history, we can clearly see that we're in phase six now, which is totalitarianism. And that's where you get dictatorial government and leaders ruling from a position of creating as much fear as possible in the nation. There's a massive amount of censorship and propaganda, which leads to what they prefer. And many world leaders have specifically come out and said this, that they want to be the single source of truth. Now, that's not how science works. Science works in a debate and a discussion and a putting different views on the table and analyzing the pros and cons of each. But many countries around the world have moved into the single source of truth phase. And as a result, that often leads to large civil uprisings. We've seen protests all over the world, and that's a natural outcome from when you see this totalitarian behavior. So some of the figures where we saw behavior that fits this bracket squarely is Trudeau, Ardern, Macron, Rutte, Schwab, Gates, and Fauci. Those were all displaying very simplistic views of the world. This is the way we must address these risks and nothing else. Now, interestingly, every single one of the countries with the harshest lockdowns, all of their leaders were people who graduated from the World Economic Forum's Young Global Leader Program. And that includes Cyril Ramaphosa, who graduated in 1993, before they called it the Young Global Leaders Program, and before South Africa had the first all-race election. So Ramaphosa was one of the early graduates of this program. The reason I mention that is because all those graduates are taught to think in a very specific way about how the world works. And it tends to be very hubristic without allowing debate or discussion, nuanced discussion in any way. Let's move on. Okay, so let's talk a little bit more about this single source of truth. What it results in is a huge perversion of science, and in this case specifically health science to do with the pandemic and climate science to do with changing climate. For every policy that is put out by the World Economic Forum, there's hundreds, if not thousands, of scientists showing the complete opposite of the information that's presented by the WEF. So we obviously don't have time to go into any examples, but I have a huge body of science that's been collected from credible scientists showing that, firstly, climate change happens naturally and it's not man-made. And secondly, any effort that we can do is hubristic in the extreme to believe that we can stop a naturally occurring occurrence. So there's two sides to the coin. In fact, there's many sides to the coin, but we never see that debate taking place. It's always just accepted that this these are the approaches that we have to take for climate change. So I've mentioned already, when there's a binary view of the world, either you agree with climate change or you don't, or you're pro-vax or you anti-vax, it cuts off this ability to have intelligent discussion and nuanced debate. We're forced into either or situations. And ultimately, these simple outcomes makes it easier to manipulate and control the way people think about these systemic risks, specifically using the algorithms of social media. It is very easy to tell just by your likes and your engagement on Facebook, for example, whether you're anti-vax or pro-vax, just as an example. And then you fed more of that information, and our thinking is entirely kept in bubbles. You've heard of filter bubbles before, and that's really what that's talking about. And then further, the risks specifically mentioned in the South African risks report are as a result of World Economic Forum policies. It's not necessarily only as a result of internal strife, of which we have plenty. There's no question about that. But if you look at Sri Lanka, who specifically wanted to achieve the world's highest ESG score, achieving those or getting to those accomplishments means that you undermine the way you produce food for your country. And we saw the news headlines and what happened there. So this is the important point that I want to make, is that the risks that we face, as identified by the World Economic Forum, are very often because of policies that they impose. So it's just a different way of looking at where those risks come from. And so setting aside their risk report for a moment, because I don't particularly want to go through it in any detail, I believe that we're at the cusp of a brand new era. And this is my preposterous proposition. And maybe it's not so preposterous. Perhaps we should allow for collapse to take place because it makes way for new possibilities. The European Enlightenment could not have occurred unless the Roman Empire collapsed. And maybe there's a new enlightenment waiting to happen when we step away about thinking about risks the way we have been doing. In the change space, many people say, you use the Einstein quote that Anthony used earlier, that we must think differently. And yet we still think very much the same. All of the renewable energy thinking is pretty much the same thinking. There's no fresh new thinking coming out of that space. So just as the collapse of the Roman and Byzantine empires created a power vacuum that was filled by new and innovative ideas, so too is the collapse of our current system, giving rise to new ways of thinking and new modes of governance. And as I said, I've spent time in this space. The number of interesting initiatives underway is unbelievable. Now, interestingly, this is where South Africa can play a leading role, perhaps even on the world stage. And the reason I say that is because only class-based societies collapse. And that's because it starts with a simple division of labor, where we all have our own specific tasks in society. That division of labor eventually leads to the 1% problem. And what the 1% problem always leads to collapse. That's what history tells us. There's no conspiracy theory there. Now, the alternative to a class-based civilization is a values-based society. And the longest surviving values-based civilization is the Khoisan, which started here in Southern Africa. So there are many lessons that we can learn from that. The big challenge, though, is that their traditions and cultures are passed on verbally. And so there is nothing documented or very little documented about how they do governance and what a values-based society might look like. Now, I love this quote by Dr. Suleiman, who's a South African doctor, and he's the founder of Gift of the Givers. He says, we need only four principles to fix this country. We don't need money. We need spirituality, morality, values, and ethics. You fix that and you fix the entire country. We'll have a surplus of money overflowing because we'll do things the right way, in an honest way, with integrity. And that, to me, is the essence of all of the risks that we face now. There's no integrity in the way these risks are approached. Now, another interesting individual that may help us with this values-based society is Professor Louis Herman. He's a professor of political science at the University of Hawaii, but he was born in apartheid South Africa, and he grew up exploring the Roberg coastline with his Khoisan friends. So over a period of many years, he got to know their culture really well by being taken to ancient sites and shown ceremonies and all the rest. And he took what he'd learned and he's written an extensive book called Future Primal. I highly recommend it if you can get your hands on it. It's not easy to do so. I've actually got a PDF that you can download. Follow that link there. Well worth the read. And so he's got really interesting ideas about how we can move the nation forward, but based on a society of values. And his body of work in Hawaii now is called Polyecology, I think it is, where he's investigating or researching with his students exactly what might it take to shift from a class-based society into a values-based society. So as we wrap up, I know that allowing the old to collapse to make way for the new is a bit of a scary notion to get our head around. But fortunately, there's thousands of people around the world who are already thinking and working along these lines. And the interesting thing is that in all of their initiatives, all of the research they're doing, not once do they ever refer to anything like the World Economic Forum risk reports or anything of that ilk. And I've been in this space for 15 years. I've seen some really profound stuff happening. And quite frankly, that's the way I think is an alternative to worrying about the risks. Interestingly, just last week, Jordan Peterson announced on the Joe Rogan podcast that he and a bunch of his friends are launching a consortium that will propose an alternative to the World Economic Forum. Now, I'm not sure that he's the 100% best person on the planet to do that. But again, we're being shown two binary options, Jordan Peterson or Klaus Schwab and the World Economic Forum. But personally, I am all for an alternative way of approaching systemic risks to what the World Economic Forum positions. Thanks for hearing me out. And let's hope that has stimulated some interesting questions and answers during the session. Thank you.
Wow. Thank you both, Anthony and Michael. Your presentations were just mind-blowing and helping us to reflect and see things really differently. And Anthony, when you spoke about what we see depends on what we focus on, and that's just what it is, so you realize that most of the time we're doing what we are intervening, we are trying to solve particular problems, we just focus on what we are seeing and that's what we know, and everything else is outside, but not understanding the interconnections and the interrelationship and the complexity all of that actually causes. So yeah, that was just like, because I looked at my desk, I found a blue key holder here, but I couldn't see red, but it's here, it really is, but I didn't remember seeing it. So yeah, that exercise was quite powerful. Thank you so much. Michael, thank you also for your presentation. Also getting into history, I think is quite useful. It really helps us to see where we're coming from, rather than just focusing on where we're going, we really trying to rush and get everything going, firefighting kind of thing, and no time to reflect. So thank you so much. Your presentation really took us back. And I think that's where my first question is going to come from, Michael. My question is going to be to you. And this is regarding the fourth industrial revolution. So you mentioned that in your presentation that there's a time that the two industrial revolutions happened in the UK and in the US. And we know that those industrial revolutions are what created the economy as we see it today. Now we have talked about the fourth industrial revolution, right? And which is an infusion of artificial intelligence, robotics, Internet of Things, genetic engineering, quantum computing, and lots more. There's a lot, like it looks like every day new things are coming up. And my question to you would be, how do you see that being useful You spoke about the different societies that we can, you know, we can actually see that this society, this is what it has brought us, and the value-based society that you are sort of proposing. How do you see 4IR working in that kind of value-based society, seeing that we already there?
So my answer will hopefully be a little controversial. I'm not a fan of the Fourth Industrial Revolution at all. And the reason I say that is because I visited the CSIR in Pretoria to go and see our own Fourth Industrial, I forget what they call it, but it's the Center for Training People in the Fourth Industrial Revolution. And the entire intent is to remove employment. It is all about robotics and all about artificial intelligence. And when I ask the people showing me around, but what is this going to do for employment in the country? They look at me with a blank stare. So in other words, what we're trying to do is get to, and this is where the hubristic thinking comes in. The Fourth Industrial Revolution is influenced by people who want fewer people involved. They want to concentrate wealth and forget the rest of everybody who isn't able to concentrate that wealth. So the Fourth Industrial Revolution is not looking after the needs of citizens. And I've had numerous challenging conversations with the 4IR guys in South Africa, and not one of them can show me how 4IR is good for people. It's good for the few who happen to control the technology. But what about the rest of us? So I'm not a fan at all. What we should be focusing much more on is creativity and joy and the ability to go out and have fun. None of that exists in 4IR. And the technology is impressive. There's no question about it. The stuff they've got in Pretoria is amazing, but it's not for the good of the people. And for me, that's what counts. If you're not taking your citizenry with you, then why bother?
Yeah. But I guess what you're saying is basically to say that we can actually use 4IR in a good way and still manage to come up with this value-based society. We in a way and still manage to use the technology in a way that saves us as communities, I guess. But yeah, I'm going to go back to you, Anthony, and ask you a question. And it's related to the narrow focus, you know, that we have in looking at particular issues. And yeah, my question is really about the complexity. So once we narrow our focus and say we're looking at climate change, for example, or we are looking at poverty, or we are looking at xenophobia or crime or whatever issue that we want to tackle, right? But all these issues are interconnected. This is what we've been seeing all along, and realizing that not understanding the interconnectedness of these issues is actually creating more problems, if I can put it like that. So, then how do we put everything together? If you're looking at climate change and saying we don't want to narrow our focus and we want to anticipate risk, you spoke about anticipation, and you've also done work in futures thinking. I'm sure you'll be able to, grab some concepts from anticipation and futures thinking, and just share your perspective around how then do we look at these things holistically? Because already as it is, it's complex.
Oh, that's a great question. Again, thank you very much for that question. It's powerful. So, and you use the key word there. I think if I could drop on that word, you talked about perspective. I think perspective is what it's all about with our narrow focus. You know, we end up coming looking at a wicked problem from one perspective. Perhaps it's a public health perspective. Perhaps it's a political perspective. What we have to really do is bring multiple perspectives around the table to look at it from different perspectives. From different views. Picasso is a perfect example. When you look at some Picasso's work, I remember I was in southern France in one of the art galleries, and I looked at Picasso's work. I'm saying, my kids can draw better than this. I just don't get it. But then I heard the curator of the museum. He said, what Picasso did, he looked at the object from all different perspectives, then superimposed all those perspectives on the canvas. And I think that's what we have to do as well. We have to bring a whole bunch of different perspectives and then view, see how it looks. Another example, I was doing some work on better understanding human trafficking. So, you know, I bring in the public health people, I bring in physicists, I bring in, and what was really cool, I brought in an artist. I bring an artist, I call them an artist in residence. And I want them to capture what the experience of human trafficking is all about, because that becomes a data point. And the artist is not about creating a pretty picture, it's about thinking. And what they do is bring in a different way of thinking to the table. So I think when we start to, if you want to better understand and manage some of these systemic risks and these issues of poverty, of climate change, these wicked problems, it's all going to come down to bringing the different perspectives around the table to have that conversation where we have that paradigm shift. You know, we talk about the collapse of society. I think it's really the collapse of ideas. Really want to look at where old ideas collapse, new ideas emerge, the paradigm shift is what it's all about. And that only comes about by bringing those and embracing the multiple perspectives, like indigenous knowledge, like the artists, like physicists, like social scientists, everyone around the table. And when we think about futures thinking, we think about design thinking, the first step in design thinking is empathy. So those who are experiencing some of these risks are the ones that are gonna have to speak about it. And we have to feel that. The rest of the solution space has to experience and understand what that risk feels like. So that empathy point on design thinking, which is critical in any type of social innovation, is key. And that brings the whole notion again of perspective, bringing the people who are vulnerabilized to the table as well to articulate what the experience of those risks are.
Thank you so much. And I'll follow up with another question, but that will go to both of you, Michael and Anthony, or anybody else. You know, the chat box is open. If you want to speak, you can raise your hand. We really want it to be an open conversation. Oh, yeah. Thank you, Nick. Nick, you can go ahead, Nick.
Thanks very much. I mean, both fascinating presentations. I wanted to ask on a more sort of practical bent, how do we build capacity in terms of getting the key decision makers, the people who are leading the institutions currently, to understand what we are starting to understand and what you two gentlemen clearly understand very, very well? I mean, I have a challenge. I work in a strategic communications firm based in the Middle East, and I find it devastating how little the ministers and the CEOs that we work with actually understand the depth of the problems that we are facing. They are so focused on their tiny little areas of expertise. And when you introduce the concept of complexity, you get looked at like you're mad. So how do we go about building that kind of capacity so that more and more people can understand what you're talking about?
I'll start off, actually. That's a great question, actually. And how do we change? Again, when you look at the iceberg model, that mindset is at the foundation piece. So what we want to create that capacity is create a mindset, create new mental models, introduce new mental models. I remember I was holding a workshop in Papua New Guinea with security teams, and the government was there. And at the end of the five-day workshop, we had sort of a debrief. And one of the gentlemen said, you know, with the introduction of systems thinking, he will never look at the world the same way again. And I got similar comments when I was in Cote d'Ivoire in Senegal. And I think that's what we have to do. We actually have to, if we want to call it, educate the senior leaders in terms of what systems thinking, what complexity is all about. And really that empathy piece in design thinking, get them not only to, you know, intellectually think about it, but to experience what that's all about through a little workshop. Then as a, you know, whenever I have these workshops, then the lights come on saying, I get it now. And then they have to go away and start thinking, okay, our world has just changed upside down. You know, our initial plan or a strategic vision is now has to be realigned and reshaped. Let's have the dialogue in shape. So that's how I would view that, sort of building that capacity.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, thanks so much. My question was actually quite related to yours, Nick, because I was thinking about how people have got so divergent perspectives that they don't even want to sit in the same room. They don't even want to see each other. And yet these are the, we need to all come to the table. It's our world and these are our problems. We need to tackle them somehow. And yeah, my question is around that. I know, Anthony, you explained about how empathy is a crucial element of design thinking, but bringing people with different divergent, views and positions, and also maybe from your background in security and defense, you have an understanding of, you know, how can this actually work? How do we bring those people to in the same place? And then that's the first step. But then how do we get them to have a shared vision?
Wow, that's a tough question. And that's a good question as well. So I guess one of the big things, how do you bring people that don't want to sit at the same table at the same table? That's probably one of the big questions. So it's really about trying to find what is common among these people. For example, they all want to contribute in some way. So find that sort of common element of contribution so they can actually come around the table. When I look at kids come have diverse backgrounds, but they throw a soccer ball on the floor and everyone starts playing together. So it's the same sort of philosophy. You want to bring something that people can recognize and saying, I see myself in that, and now I'm going to come and participate. That's the biggest thing. It's just allowing them to see themselves, not as external, but as in the problem space. And then that's how you're going to bring them together. I think that's the way to do it.
Yeah, okay, good. And maybe, Michael, the same question to you, but related more specifically to the value-based society that you proposed. Yeah, very interesting concept, and I think would like to share, like to hear more about that. But in relation to bringing people to understand how a value-based society can actually work, bringing everybody together, because right now we are just in that space where it's blaming each other to say, oh, you didn't do this, you failed to do this, you didn't do this correctly. But if we were supposed to now build this new society, how do you see it happening, Michael?
Thank you, great question. And these are not easy ones, I'm sure Anthony will agree. But to give a little perspective before I answer the question directly, the context here and the reason I personally think that it's better to allow the system to collapse, the context is your 1% problem. And the 1%, we normally think of that as wealth, but a more underlying, deep, entrenched concern is hubris. And by hubris is the arrogance and the absolute belief that I have some other big solution. And that's not only in government. It also happens in the people sector, you know, people working in the change agent space. I've been to numerous conferences where everybody comes saying, you know, this is the solution that's going to save the planet. And by the end of the weekend or the conference, everybody goes home again and nothing has been accomplished because they're all sitting in the space of thinking what I bring to the table is the only solution. Instead of saying it's one piece of a jigsaw puzzle. So I think we're going to sadly still be in that space of hubristic thinking for quite some time. And I don't know the answer. I've seen it play out over and over again. Maybe one other thing just to add to Nicholas's question earlier, one of my favorite quotes, and I've just gone blank about who said it, but it's difficult to convince somebody something on which their salary depends them not understanding. Now, specifically in the South African government with nepotism and so on, people couldn't care less about systemic issues because they're profiting handsomely. The Just Energy Transition Program is one of the worst things that can be forced on South Africa because of the debt it's going to create. But it's also going to create make a lot of people very, very wealthy. So that's all they're concerned about. They could not care less about the fact that there are systemic risks. And so your question is a challenging one. It's not an easy one to even know how to approach.
Yeah. Elko, you want to say something about storytelling?
I think this is a fascinating session. I mean, I'm a global nomad, but I'm very impressed with the presentations. I've got a few comments. Playfully, provocatively, but always constructive. The first one is that when Tony is saying that building capacity, you do that by educating leaderships to avoid tunnel vision and expand their views, that pre-assumes that these leaders are reasonable. And that's what Michael says as well. It is not necessarily that these leaders are reasonable, and you cannot argue, you cannot convince people with arguments or reasons when you are dealing with clearly unreasonable people. That was one. This, the second comment on Anthony's presentation is it's great, but it reminds me of that 95% of people's time and energy is dedicated to talking about the what question, the diagnosis. And I would wish that 85% of that energy would be spent on looking at therapy. Because the what question that is very strongly central to your presentation, Anthony, I mean, it's not about the what question, I think. It's about the how question. And I think I often would wish that we focus more on that. And that brings me to my international work, which is which happens under the banner of going from risk to resilience. How do we get there? Because risk is where the problem is where the what question is, but resilience is where the opportunity lies. But that requires the how question. And that is also central to, as I said in the chat, to my role as one of the architects of a center of excellence at the University of South Africa. And they decided to do adaptation or resilience. And one of the things that we plan on doing there is to set up a traveling roadshow throughout South Africa. And these are called pracademia, prac-ademia events that are interactive, and they bring together academics with practitioners, community practitioners. So that you bring together the what and the how questions in a structured fashion, creating by design and not by retrofit, a structured interaction that leads to harvesting recommendations on how to solve the 9 universal roadblocks that stand in the way of applying lessons learned, but also stand in the way of transitioning from a risk-based approach to a resilience-based approach. And that is what we are going to pilot in South Africa. That's very exciting stuff. Community projects, we are working with the Rotary International in South Africa, because they're involved in Colombia. But it's a collaborative, the Center of Excellence is by design a platform, a collaboration of many, that's all inclusive and transdisciplinary. And I'm not sitting here because I want to advertise the Center of Excellence, because it's going to happen anyway. I'm just getting excited when I listen to these presentations and the common sense that clearly is needed. It's just a matter of how. One critical comment I also have for Michael, before you guys think that I only reserved that for Anthony, and that is what he is saying, that collapse makes way for new possibilities. And I agree with many of the things that he says, including his criticism on the WEF agenda and also the historical cycles. I think that's brilliant stuff. But when you say collapse makes way for new possibilities, that pre-assumes that there is a point of recovery. And the scary thing about climate change, for instance, is that there may not be a point of return. So for an earthquake and a cyber, a pandemic and a cybersecurity, there always is a point of recovery, historically. But the question whether that is the case for climate change is a troublesome question that a lot of people dive for, because it's not linked, it's a non-linear question. Anyway, those were just a few comments. But again, I'm very impressed. And I cordially invite you to stay in touch with me and see how we can work together on creating something of value and of common sense.
Thank you so much. Sorry, Linda. that was some good insight that you just gave them. Definitely, we will want to be in touch with you. The work that you're doing seems quite interesting. As the SI Cape Town Hub, why not? We quite interested to expand more. I know the topic is quite exciting. You know, like myself, I had a few questions that I had for Michael, but I don't know if maybe because we are almost there, the time is almost up, but I think we can push for maybe 3 to 4 minutes to also allow a few people that have some questions.
Yeah.
I saw Abili had a question or comment.
Yes.
So we can just collect a few ideas in the room and then we can wrap up. Abili?
Quickly, I say thank you very much. And mine's probably to Michael, and I want to tap into his insights on the global South, really, which is the African space, which of course South Africa almost share the same context in terms of social inequalities. The resource pocket that really funds most of these activities is mostly coming from donation, especially in Africa. And the perspective that these implementations are done, or these resource pockets are done, is that they tend to reduce activities into small pieces so that they manage how these implementations are done. And if we're looking at issues systemically and from a wider perspective, how then, what leverage points must we tap in? And especially where systems thinking is just taking shape in Africa, and yet the resource packet that funds these activities in Africa is coming from another point. How do we begin to create a narrative to our donors that instead of looking at these activities as small pieces, and then we begin to look at them as a whole. Thank you.
May I jump in, Linda, to answer that? Because it's something that's very close to my heart. Creating value flows is the underlying question. And the existing investment model, whether you're going to donors or funders or raising private capital, does not work in the space that we're trying to create. Now, what inspires me is a group called the Hanseatic League. Now, these were some traders that realized what was happening as the Roman Empire was busy collapsing. And they looked at the playground of the Mediterranean Sea, because that's where most of the trade routes were. And they said, hold on, we don't even want to play in that space anymore. We're going to go and create an entirely new playground. And so they moved to the Baltic and the North Seas. And they created an absolutely thriving, completely separate trade routes and all the rest. And their success eventually led to Protestantism, and Protestantism eventually led to the Enlightenment. And this was just from a group of traders who decided, we don't want to go and play in this playground with these rules, we're going to go and create our own playground. Now, the tools that we have available to do that now are far more interesting than mere ships. We've got blockchain, and we've got crypto, and we've got all of the tools are available for us to start doing this. So I think what's going to happen from an evolutionarily coherent perspective is that we will get people coming together and starting to create these healthy value flows. But however we think of investment now is not going to work in this new playground. So I don't have a specific answer, but hopefully that framing gives you an idea of where I think we could go with this.
Thank you so much, Michael, for your response to Abili. And the reality is this conversation can never be in, you know, 1 hour is never adequate to completely, you know, go through everything. There's a lot to talk about, so much ideas coming up, and unfortunately we have run out of time. So thank you so much for your attendance, for taking your time to explore the complexity surrounding the global risk landscape together with us today. And maybe for those who are not yet part of our community, the SI Cape Town Hub, and would like to join us, the link to our online platform is being placed in the chat. Maybe one of Asen or Yasmin, you can drop the link there. So those who are not part of us can join the community. And thank you again for joining us. Have a good evening, morning, or afternoon, depending on where you are in the world. Until next time. Goodbye.
Thank you.
Thank you very much, everyone. Great.
Yeah. Okay. Okay. Bye-bye.
Bye-bye.